जैनब बिन जहसल असदिया मदर ऑफ द फेथफुल मे अल्लाह बी प्लीज विद हर। अल्लाह सेज अल्लाह आई हैव नॉट पुट फॉर एनी मैन टू हार्ट इनसाइड हिज बॉडी नाइदर हैज ही मेड योर वाइफ whom you declare to be like your mother back your real mother. Ad-dihar is a saying of a husband to his wife, you are to me like the back of my mother, that is, you are unlawful for me to approach. Nor has he made your adopted son your real son, that is, but you are saying with your mouth. But Allah says the truth and he guides to the right way. Call them adopted son by the names of their father, that is more just with Allah. But if you know not their father's name, call them your brothers in faith and mawalikum, your freed slave. And there is no sin on you concerning that in which you made a mistake, except in regard to what your heart deliberately intend. And Allah is ever oft forgiving, most merciful. Quran chapter 33 verse 4 and 5. Allah also says, it is not for a believer, man or woman, when Allah and His Messenger have decreed a matter, that they should have any option in their decision. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger, he has indeed strayed in a plain error. And remember when you said to him, Zayd ibn Haritha, the freed slave of the Prophet on whom Allah has bestowed grace by guiding him to Islam, and you, O Muhammad, too, have done favor by manumitting him. Keep your wife to yourself and fear Allah. But you did hide in yourself, that is, what Allah has already made known to you, that He will give her to you in marriage, that which Allah will make manifest. And you did fear the people, that is, they are saying that Muhammad married the divorced wife of his manumitted slave, whereas Allah had a better wife, that you should fear him. So when Zayd had accomplished his desire from her, that is, divorced her, we gave her to you in marriage, so that in future there may be no difficulty to believers in respect of the marriage of the wife of their adopted son. When the latter have no desire to keep them, that is, they have divorced them, and Allah's command must be fulfilled. There is no blame on the Prophet in that which Allah has made legal for him. That has been Allah's way with those who have passed away of the prophets of old, and the command of Allah is a decree determined. Quran chapter 33 verses 36-38. Personalities and events are interwoven, and rules and ordainments are revealed. So anybody who wants to write or talk about the mother of the faithful Zainab bin Jahash should be conversant with all this. He should do so in accordance with what the necessity of the research and study demand, and within the literary and topical limits, without losing the purpose, so that no aspect which overrides another, and in order to avoid a mistake that could lead to the abyss of ignorance and desire. Dear reader, prefacing this discussion with clear verses from the Quran does not in any way mean that I am going to make an exegesis of the verses. That is an entirely different field. The aspect of the verses that concerns us here is that with which we can support a fact, and in which we can seek arbitration in the course of exchanging view. Allah says the truth and He guides to the right way. Zayd bin Haritha. The story of Zayd's life in the house of Khadija is well known and does not need any repetition. But What we are concerned with here is the proper adaptation of desire. Adaptation was a very popular habit during the time of ignorance. Jayat's father, Haritha ibn Surahil, had known of his son being in Makkah in the house of Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the husband of Khadija bin Khuwaylid. So he quickly came to Makkah in the company of a brother of his, wanting to get his son back and paying whatever ransom was needed, for before that he was very sad and tearful. Of the poem, he used to repeat an expression of his sorrow about Zayd, the one whose meaning is rendered as follows: I wept over Zayd, for I didn't know what happened to him. Is he still alive, or he has been seized by death? By Allah, I don't know if I may ask. Were you snatched by the even ground, or you were snatched by the mountain? Would that I knew whether you will be back, for it suffices me in this world that you return to me quickly. Whenever the sun rises, it reminds me of him, and when the rain falls, the memory of him comes to me. When the wind blows, it tears his memory. How often is my sorrow and fear over him? I will make of the camel over the land his great effort, and I shall not relent in roaming about the land in search of him until the camel becomes weary and tired, or until the death comes to me. Then every man will die, even if he is deluded by hope. The above lines sufficiently show us the suffering of Haritha from the agony of his missing of Jayal. Every word, rather, every letter of this line indicates how sad and distressed he was. We can notice the tears that fall from Haritha's eyes with every poetic form he exudes. I take Allah as a witness that each time I read these poetic lines, I am seized by shock, and I share with Haritha his emotions, and when tears roll down from my eyes. Haritha and his brother Ka'ab entered the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and then addressed him thus: O son of Abdul Muttalib, O son of the leader of his people, you are the inhabitant of Allah's sacred city. You give relief to the sufferer and you feed the captive. We come to you because of our son who is your slave. Grant us a favor and show kindness to us in his ransom. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked, what is that? They said, it is Zayd ibn Haritha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, is there anything besides that? Call him and let him choose. If he chooses to go with you, that is better for you, and I will not take any ransom from you. And if he chooses to stay with me, by Allah, I am not going to prefer taking ransom above someone who chooses to stay with me. They said, you have increased us in fairness. The Prophet then called Zayd and asked him whether he knew these two men. Zayd said, yes, this is my father and this is my uncle. The Prophet then said, I am, as you know, me, and you have seen my companionship with you. So choose between me and them. Zayd said, I am not going to prefer anyone to you. You are to me like a father and uncle. Zayd's father and his uncle then said, are you going to prefer slavery to freedom, and are you going to prefer others to your father, uncle, and your family? Zayd said, yes, I have seen in this man, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, something that will not make me prefer anyone to him. Zayd, son of Muhammad. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that, he took Zayd out to the place near the black stone and said, I take you all as witness that Zayd is my son. He can inherit me and I can inherit him. When Zayd's father and uncle saw that, they were happy and they went away. Let us ponder a little bit over Haritha and his brother's statement. You have increased us in fairness. Fairness is justice. The historical fact testifies that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave both men more than fairness when he firstly gave Zayd the freedom of choice, and that if he preferred to go with his father, he was free to do so, and secondly, that he would not take any ransom from him. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam then attained the highest level of justice and fairness in human relations with Zayd when he took a group of Quraysh as witness in the preaching of the sacred mosque that he had adopted Zayd as a son and abided by the implications of this adoption in all matters relating to a father and his son. This is the third act of fairness on his part. This concept of justice was a human norm and a followed tradition of the time of ignorance. Noble people who possessed the qualities of manliness keenly followed it and were proud of it. It was not only in the case of adoption, but in many other matters as well. When the dawn of Islam appeared and its illuminating light beamed through the minds and hearts of the righteous, of the rightly guided, and the darkness of the age of ignorance was eliminated, the concept of fairness then became defined by the divine law that is more just with Allah. The Quran says, "Nor he made your adopted son your real son, that is but your saying to your mouth. But Allah says the truth, and he guides to the right way. Call them adopted son by the names of their father, that is more just with Allah. But if you know not their father's name, call them your brothers in faith and mawalikum, that is your free slaves. And there is no sin on you concerning that in which you made a mistake, except in regard to what your heart deliberately intend. And Allah is of forgiving, most merciful." Quran chapter 33 verses 4 and 5. With the revelation of these clear verses on the heart of the noble messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the system of adoption as a custom and tradition was abrogated because it was neither truth nor reality. It was for some time a human fairness governed by manliness. It was only an emotional feeling free of fundamentals, and it did not transcend a word spoken by the mouth. That is but your saying with your mouth. So Zayd returned to the originality of his lineage and turned from Zayd ibn Muhammad to Zayd ibn Haritha. And it was only the link of religion and faith that remained between the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Zayd radiyallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then chose Zainab bint Jahasul Ashadiya as a wife for his freed slave Zayd ibn Haritha. Zainab was a Quraysi girl. She was beautiful and of noble lineage. A great number of Quraysi young men had wanted to marry her, but she rejected all of them out of pride in her origin and high lineage. She was from the highest branch of the clan of Bani Asad. Her mother was Humayma, the daughter of Abdul Muttalib, the chief of Quraysh. She therefore did not want to marry, but only a nobleman. That was the complexity in her life, and it was of the remnants of the days of ignorance in her heart. When the Messenger of Allah informed her of his intention, she exceeded, raged, and refused. She narrated the story to her brother Abdullah. So Abdullah came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to talk to him and ask him to have a second look at the matter. The family of Banu Jahsh had all embraced Islam, and the faith has penetrated into their hearts and overwhelmed them. Abdullah asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Are you pleased that Zainab should marry Zayd?" The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Yes." Abdullah then said, "We are pleased with what pleases you, O Messenger of Allah, and we shall not disobey your command." Zainab was also satisfied, albeit reluctantly. That was in response to the command of Allah. It is not for a believer, man or woman, when Allah and His Messenger have decreed a matter, that they should have any option in their decision. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger, he has indeed strayed in a plain error. Quran chapter 33, verse 36. Thus did the marriage of Zainab to Zayd take place, and a dark phase in the journey of history was closed, and a new and bright phase was opened. This new page spoke the truth through the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Verily, the most honorable of you with Allah is that believer who has piety." Quran chapter 49, verse 13. And the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "There is no superiority for an Arab over a non-Arab, or for a non-Arab over an Arab, except through piety." A ship of life then moved with them through a fathomless sea. Zayd was a favorite of Allah's Messenger and the dearest of all people to him. He was always in his company and follows him about like a shadow. He was his companion during his journey to Taif. He instructed him to bring his family from Makkah to Medina during migration, and he made him a commander of a number of contingents to fight the polytheists. Aisha radiallahu anha said, "Had Zayd been alive on the day Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, he would have assigned him a responsibility. Zayd was undoubtedly a great energy of faith. That is why he was able to endure the waves of yelling provoked by the violent wind of Zainab, and he tried as much as he could to paddle the ship far from the stormy current with the wisdom of an experienced sailor. But Zainab was in a perpetual and unquiet storm. Many a time she had injured the pride and the nobleness of faith in the heart of Zayd by her constantly reminding him of her high nobility and hurting him with that." When Zayd could no longer bear the matter, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and complained to him. He opened his mind to him and sought a way out. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him to keep his voice. The complaint was made repeatedly and the answer was the same. The Quran narrates the event to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in clear verse, "And remember when you said to him," that is Zayd ibn Haritha, the freed slave of the Prophet, on whom Allah bestowed grace by guiding him to Islam, "and you, O Muhammad, too have done favor by manumitting him, keep your wife to yourself and fear Allah. But you did hide in yourself," that is what Allah has already made known to you, "that He will give her to you in marriage, and that which Allah will make manifest, and you did fear the people," that is, they are saying that Muhammad married the divorced wife of his manumitted slave, whereas Allah had a better right that you should fear him. Chapter 33, verse 37. Here, dear reader, some ignorant people among the Orientals and Occidentals who are advocates of evil launched one of their dirty attacks against Islam and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say, "May Allah destroy their mouth and disgrace them," that Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved Zainab and was stunned by her beauty. They claimed that he came one day to Zainab's house asking for Zayd, and Zainab came out to meet hurriedly before she could dress herself up properly, so some attractive part of her body was exposed. Zayd was not at home, so Zainab cheerfully invited him in, and he thanked her and left while saying, "Glory be to Allah who twists hearts." The advocates of evil, even ignorantly, cite to support their fabrication the saying of Allah, "But you did hide in your but you did hide in yourself. That is what Allah has already made known to you, that He will give her to you in marriage, that which Allah will make manifest. They do all this to diminish the status of prophethood, but the reality in which there is no dispute is entirely different from this. This poisoned arrow of fitna and error is disproved by the conclusion of the quoted verse in which the purpose of the divine commandment is explained. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "So when Zayd had accomplished his desire from her, that is, divorced her, we gave her to you in marriage, so that in future there may be no difficulty to the believer in respect of the marriage of the wife of their adopted son, and the latter have no desire to keep them, that is, they have divorced them, and Allah's command must be fulfilled." Chapter 33, verse 37. Since adoption was then the order of the day and a pure pre-Islamic culture that transcripted over the reality, so was marrying the divorced wife of an adopted son regarded as taboo, because it was regarded as marrying the wife of one's son, who then has a greater right to establish the truth and put it in its rightful place and remove the difficulty in legislation than the one with whom the message was sent, who had the greater right to be the excellent model that should be followed. Indeed, the Messenger of Allah, that is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have a good example to follow. Quran chapter 33 verse 21. What was it that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was trying to hide and for which he feared people? Was it the love for Zainab as claimed by the ignorant and the people of desire and evil intention? Or was it legislation of the truth and abrogation of an ignorant and erroneous custom? This question was clearly answered by the above verse. It is because it is the command of Allah, and Allah's command must be fulfilled. It is true. If it is true that he loved Zainab, then what prevented him from marrying her? Also, what was the thing that Zayd had accomplished from Zainab? The Arabs of the time of ignorance were governed by false deities of all colors and forms, false deities of idols and statues, false deities of casting lots and divination by arrows, false deities of masters and slaves, and disregarding the humanity of man, false deities of money and usury, false deities of intoxicant, adultery, burying female newborns alive, and all other vices, false deities of fortune telling and sorcery, false deities of tribalism, war and looting. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had relentlessly lived all his life in destroying all these false deities. He laid a practical example with his own person and his close relatives, so that the balance of truth may stand firm without any prejudice or partiality. The purpose of Zayd's marriage to Zainab was therefore to destroy the false deity of racial discrimination and abolition of the segregation of the time of ignorance. This incident reminds us of the Prophet's standing and sermon in his farewell pilgrimage, when he said, "All usury is abrogated, and the first usury I will abrogate is that of Al-Abbas." The divorce then took place between Zayd and Zainab. Revelation came from the heaven that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam should marry Zainab to complete the form and legislation of law, and in order to remove the despicable and heavy burden that had been on the people. The event from the beginning to the end is replicated in laws and verses that are recited for eternity. Add to this the fact that no companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned by name in the Book of Allah, in spite of many rules and reasons of revelation, except Zayd alone, without mentioning the name of the other party, Zainab. It was reported that Ibn Abbas said, "When Zainab heard the news of her divorce from Zayd and her engagement to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, She prostrated to Allah in gratitude. Zainab then lived in the house of prophethood as a mother of the faithful. She was given to observing much fasting and night prayers, and she was a pious worshipper. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would incline to her and keep her company frequently. She would incessantly mention her superiority over other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam without hurting any of them. She once told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "O Allah's Messenger, by Allah, I am not like your other wife. There is none among your wife whose father, brother, or family had not married her half to you except me. For it is Allah from above the heaven who married me off to you." Whenever Aisha radiallahu anha remembered her, she would invoke Allah's mercy on her and describe her, especially concerning her stand during the incident of Flanders, saying, "Allah protected her with attention, that is, from wading into the matter." Aisha also mentioned that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The quickest of you to join me is the one with the longest hand." What did they understand from this statement? Aisha narrated that the Prophet's wife would go to a wall and stretch up their hands in order to know which of them had the longest hand. It would be noted that Zainab was not tall, but she was the first of the Prophet's wife to die after him. It is then understood that what the Prophet ﷺ meant by long hand was charity and generosity. And among the purest sources of income is the work done with one's hand. Aisha said, "Zainab was very proud with Allah's Messenger. The Prophet ﷺ would frequently keep her company. She was given to performing fasting and prayer. She was a skilled craftswoman, and she would give charity with the proceeds of her handiwork." Ibn Sa'ad reported on the authority of Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad that Zainab said, "When she was about to die, I have prepared my own sword, and Umar is going to send a sword for me. So give out one of them in charity. And if you are able to also give my loincloth in charity, you can do so." Amra bin Abdul Rahman al-Ansariya had the following to tell us. "Umar sent 5 harani cloths. 5 each of them incense. She was shrouded with them. Her sister Hamna gave out the fruit she had prepared for her own burial in charity." Amra narrated that she heard Aisha radiallahu anha said, "The praiseworthy woman, the devoted worshipper, and the refuge of the orphan and the widow is gone." Muhammad ibn Ka'ab al-Quradi said, "Zainab bin Zaid's annual grant was 12,000. She took it only once, and she started saying, 'O Allah, do not let this money catch up with me next year, because it is a trial.' She then distributed it to her kith and kin and the needy." When Umar heard that, he said, "This is a blessed woman." He then sent greetings to her and said, "The news of what you have done have reached me." So he sent her 1,000 dirham that would last her, but she treated the money as she did with the first. Zainab died in the year 20 after Hijra at the age of 53. Umar performed funeral prayer on her. May Allah be pleased with her and please her. There is indeed a lesson in her person, in her life, Zaid, in her life in the house of the prophethood, and with her co-wife, and even in her death.